We start with a story inspired by real events that happened earlier this year. Our story is about a learner and a teacher. We'll call the learner Padawan and the teacher Sensei. Padawan wants to make a fancy new watch face that looks like this. So Padawan asks Sensei, "Can you please guide me?" Sensei says, "That's easy. Here's a watch face. Take this program and change it." Padawan knows some Arduino, so Padawan tries to change the program. For those of us who are not familiar with C, this program creates a buffer of 6 characters. It converts the hour and the minute into a string. So 2 characters for the hour, 2 characters for the minute. So you get 12, 34, with a colon in between. And we set the label on the watch face, okay, by calling this function here. So we have 2 characters here, 2 characters there, that's 4 characters, plus the colon, 5. And there's a null at the end, a terminating null. So that means 6 characters. So Padawan tries to change the program. Padawan took all night to change, but failed. The next day, Padawan says, "Really sorry, Sensei. The program is acting really, really strange. All I did was add 2 new lines like this." Sensei looked at the code. So there it was, the 2 new lines right in the middle of the format string. Right. Sensei sees this and knows exactly what's wrong. And he sighs. It's 2020. There must be a better way to learn embedded programming. So we have 2 characters for the hour, 2 characters for the minute. But Padawan has added 2 new lines here. So that's 2 characters, 2 characters, 2 characters, 6. But there's also a terminating null at the end. So that should be 7 characters. So what happened is that when you have a buffer here of 6 characters, you end up with a buffer overflow problem. So Sensei asks, "Do you know what a buffer overflow problem is?" Padawan says, "Not really, but may I ask some questions?" And Padawan started asking many, many questions. Why should this be 7 characters instead of 6? What's a stack? What's a terminating null? Why does it need space if it's a null? What's sprintf? What is 02d, okay, which is the format for writing the hours and minutes? Is backslash n 1 character or 2 for the new line? So Sensei wondered, how did a simple watch face become so complicated? So Sensei said, "I'll tell you what, let's code this the safer way with snprintf. We change the sprintf to snprintf here. Snprintf requires a buffer size. So we created a bigger buffer, 64 characters here, and we pass the size of the buffer here. Of course, Padawan will start asking questions. What's snprintf? Well, to format something for printing, we call printf. So to format something into a string buffer, we call sprintf, s standing for string. To format something into a string buffer that's limited by size, we call snprintf. So n represents a size. How do we get a size of the buffer? We call size n." There was total silence. Sensei asked, "Are you still there, Padawan?" Well, Padawan has slipped away to play Fortnite, the game, never returning to embedded programming ever again because the experience was just so bad. So whose fault was it? Sensei's fault, I think. Sensei failed to provide a safe and sensible environment for learners to experiment with embedded programming. In short, it's a trap. So if you think about it, why would anybody want to go through all these hoops, to code and flash and crash, code again, flash and crash, and giving up at the end? Compare that with a game like Fortnite. You drop in, you shoot, yes, somebody kills you, but you respawn and you continue. And you get better at each time. If you compare that with embedded programming, this is like dropping into a game where you face the toughest boss. And the boss is called buffer overflow. It's no wonder that people actually give up on embedded programming and play games instead. What we need is something called a scaffold. We use it in construction. It's for building things. It's an educational term. When we talk about an instructional scaffold, We talk about a scaffold that prevents learners from falling into traps and never getting out. A scaffold also guides the learner towards more difficult topics. But we feed them one small chunk at a time, not one big bunch. So what can we do to prevent learners from falling into this trap? So let's consider this Rust version of a scaffold. Here's how we declare our variables in Rust. Notice that we use a keyword here, mute, meaning mutable. Mutable means this thing can be changed. The rule in Rust is that whatever that needs to be changed needs to be declared as mutable. And when you pass it into a function, it needs to be passed in with the mute option. So we create a buffer here. We write the hour and the minute into the buffer using a format string here. Write is actually a macro. It actually checks whether hour matches the format here and minute matches the format here. In case this string overflows a buffer, it will fail in an error. That's what expect time fail says. Rust works well with C libraries. So in this case, we are working with a C library called LVGL. So we can easily just call it like that. There is a error checking with the question mark here at the end. So in case of error, this code just quits, doesn't proceed. Right? Notice that we actually don't specify the types of variables. We don't say whether it's a char or a string. Right? We just say let. That's because Rust infers the type of our variables. So this is actually safe. It will catch learners from falling into traps because there's no way that you can cause a buffer overflow problem. It just fails in the error. And if you compare the two versions of the code, the C and the Rust, right, to create this watch face, the code is actually quite similar. We don't need to specify the types of our variables. We just let Rust do it for us. All we need to do is just to say let. You see that instead of using sprintf, we use write, which I think sounds more sensible. And to specify that a buffer will be changed, we actually pass it with the mut, mute parameter here. The format looks quite similar, hour, minute, right? We have error checking here. If the buffer overflows, it will say time fail. And we call setText to set the contents of the label. Quite similar, but there's a slight complication here because we need to deal with null-terminated strings. Strings are not null-terminated in Rust. And we have error checking here. So if this line fails, this whole function will just quit. It will not continue. So this is the safe way of writing this code in Rust. Rust actually gets a lot safer than that. It actually catches some problems that C coders won't even notice. So if you look at this part of the code here, there's actually a potential problem. We are calling a C function, setText, and we are passing a buffer. What if the buffer lives on a stack? Well, that might cause problems because if setText saves the buffer pointer for future access, the program will crash. This program will access some random location in memory and cause problems. This piece of code will not compile Rust. The Rust compiler will say this is a potential problem, and the way to fix it is that we need to create a static mutable variable. So instead of putting it into the stack, we put it into global memory, and then we pass the buffer into the function. However, now that we have static variables that can change, they're actually unsafe. Imagine two threads trying to update the buffer at the same time. We will create undefined behavior. We won't really know what's the buffer going to be. So Rust insists that we have to flag this code as unsafe. We're trying to do something that's potentially dangerous. So it's actually up to our responsibility to make sure that it's safe. In the case of RIOT, we have to make sure that this buffer is only accessed by one RIOT thread at a time. So this is how safe Rust can get. Today, we have a version of Rust that runs on RIOT for the Pinetime smartwatch. This is based on Mr. Cohen Zandberg's excellent port of RIOT to Pinetime smartwatch. Rust on RIOT has two parts, the Rust part above and the C part below. The RIOT operating system still runs in C here. Our watch face code is compiled as a Rust static library. We compile it with the NoSTD convention, which means that we don't use the Rust standard library, but we use the Rust core library, which is meant for embedded platforms. With the Rust core library, there's no heap, no dynamic memory, only the stack and static memory. We support strings and vectors in Rust, but these are not the normal standard strings and vectors that make use of heap memory. We use heapless ones. So our strings and vectors actually live on the stack and in static memory. Our watch face calls a library in C called LVGL. It's a library of UI widgets. To do that, we provide a safe wrapper that exposes a safe interface from LVGL to Rust. We have an app framework here that manages the multitasking, the display controller, and the touch controller. But why RIOT? I feel that RIOT is a modern and better OS. It's really easy to code. It has a strong, friendly community. And there's a freedom to innovate, like integrating with Rust. But we need your help to grow Rust on RIOT, fill in the missing gaps, because many Padawans, many learners are waiting to use this platform. We have a web assembly simulator for Rust on RIOT. This means that the watch face code can be compiled and viewed in a web browser. To do that, we replace the RIOT operating system by libraries from the Scripton WebAssembly library. And we interact with the web browser through the HTML canvas, getting the date and time, through JavaScript. Here's how the WebAssembly simulator looks in a web browser. LVGL can get quite cumbersome for creating watch faces. We need to arrange labels and other widgets by exact pixel positions, XY coordinates. Can we create watch faces with a declarative UI instead? So instead of putting widgets by XY coordinates, we lay them out into a table by row and by column, much like HTML. We're taking Druid, a Rust declarative UI framework, and changing it so that it renders with LVGL widgets. When we have a declarative Rust user interface, we can do many interesting things. Here's something that we created with Blockly and Druid. Visual Embedded Rust is an extension for VS Code that lets you drag and drop little blocks of program logic to create watch apps. You can see that when we drag and drop the blocks into the program, it actually generates Rust code for the watch app. When I bring my family and my pets out to the beach or to the park, I want to make sure they don't wander off too far away from me. So that I give them each a watch running this watch app that measures the proximity between the devices. So this application would be great for Bluetooth Mesh running on RIOT and Nimble, which is the open source Bluetooth stack. However, it's not that easy. To create a simple Bluetooth Mesh application, we need 2,700 lines of C code. Well, so can we use Rust on RIOT to simplify this? Maybe wrap up some of this complicated C code into a domain-specific language. We live in very strange and uncertain times. What's the new normal for developing IoT gadgets? It's now harder to get hardware in many parts of the world outside Asia. These Pogo pins here cost me $100 to ship from Singapore to US. If we can't get hardware, why not build and test on simulators and verify on real hardware remotely? So now is actually a great time to rethink and reconstruct the way we teach IoT to a whole new generation of distracted learners like our Padawan. Will Rust on RIOT save our Padawan and bring Padawan back into embedded programming? Perhaps.